20 seconds or so, next thing, or something.
20 seconds.
Get some coffee. Thanks for coming today. Very big crowd. It's great to see it. It's not just Clare people here, it's actually a lot of non-Clare people here. So thanks for taking the time out of your busy workday to be here. I'm speaking on behalf of the HERO program, Human Environment Regional Observatory of Clare, and my colleague Professor Deb Martin, who's in the back there. And special thanks to the students involved, but also Rachel Levitt, Caleb Peterson, where are you? And Pamela Dunkel as well. And part of the joy is, of being here today, is that you've just completed 8 weeks of intensive field work, interviewing of residents and foresters and city officials. And we're here today to present the findings. There are more findings than could be possibly presented in a short period of time, so you're getting to see some of the highlights of what came out of the research by the 6 students. And the agenda for today would be that we'll present for the part of an hour with questions and answers, and then I hope we'll be able to take the time to discuss some of those findings and plan for the future in terms of collaboration. So without further ado, I'll have Rachel come up first. Thanks, Rachel.
Thank you for the introduction, John. Good morning, everyone. My name is Rachel, and we are the HERO team of 2018. We, welcome to Clare University. We are really excited to present to you our Green the Gateway Cities research for this year. Minor setback. Awesome.
Yay.
Our team consists of 6 undergraduates from Clare University. We have Laura Cohen, myself, Rachel Corbin Adams, Elizabeth Lohr, Rowan Moody, Andy Pagan, and Yuna Ruiz. We are mentored by graduate students Nick Duran, Mark Healy, and we're directed by Devin Ryan and John Rogan. All right, let's jump right in. Here is an outline we have created to kind of guide everyone through the presentation. We're going to start with an introduction, go into tree survey, then lead into interview responses, and end with a summary of our findings and hopes for our future research. Now, introducing the Human Environment Regional Observatory, also known as HERO, started in 1999. We are a 6-member undergraduate research cohort led by esteemed faculty in the Graduate School of Geography. In the past, from 1999 to 2015, HERO has centered its research around land use modeling, the impacts of the Asian longhorn beetle, and placemaking assessment. From 2016 to this year, research has been focused on urban greening initiatives, the planting program process, focusing more on resident experience and policy implementation. The Green the Gateway Cities program is the focus of our presentation today, and our long-term goals is to survey trees in all of the gateway cities over time, and be able to compare them over time and create a database, in addition to creating a database. This upcoming fall and spring, we will be conducting research on a more individual level as well. So this program aims to highlight and fortify the environmental benefits of a healthy canopy cover. This graphic exemplifies trees' ability to not only curb energy costs, but benefit wildlife, enhance the community, increase property values, improve air quality, and reduce noise pollution. In other words, money and community vitality really do grow on trees. So who do these trees benefit? Introducing the Community Gateway Cities program, created in 2014 by the Department of Conservation and Recreation, a part of the Executive Office of Energy and Environmental Affairs. This program is designed to curb energy costs for residents in gateway cities by expanding tree canopy by 10% in designated planting zones. By targeting planting zones as areas with low tree canopy, older housing stock, high wind speeds, and large renter population, the Department of Conservation and Recreation Bureau of Forestry, with the help of community forestry crews, have managed to plant 8,000 trees so far. The map here represents gateway cities that HERO has surveyed in the past, Holyoke, Revere, and Chelsea, and then the gateway cities we have focused on this year, Chicopee and Fall River. So what is a gateway city exactly? According to the Massachusetts General Laws, these formerly industrial cities were targeted for redevelopment efforts and have a population between 35,000 and 250,000, with household income and average state and average education rates well below the state average. While these urban centers anchor regional economies across the state, they also face many social and economic challenges. However, it is really important to note that these cities retain many assets with unrecognized potential. Here are some scenes from the two cities we surveyed this summer, Chicopee and Fall River. Now that we have a clear definition of what a gateway city is exactly, I will introduce one of the cities we worked in this summer, Chicopee. The map on the right represents the percentage of residents within the planting zone that identify as non-white. As shown here on the left side, the population demographic distribution of Chicopee shows that the majority of residents identify as white and secondly Hispanic. As we know, these categories are not mutually exclusive, as residents may choose to identify as white and foreign-born, or white and Hispanic, etc. Chicopee is a good representation of a gateway city because of its education rate being significantly lower than that of the state, along with its relatively high Hispanic population. And now here is Fall River, a city significantly larger than Chicopee, with a population of 88,930. What is important to note here is the high percentage of foreign-born residents at 19%, making Fall River a good example of a gateway city. The map here also represents the planting zone, residents in the planting zone that identify as non-white. But what really sets Fall River apart is that its dense non-white population is mainly located in the housing authorities. And now I'm going to hand it over to Rowan, who will talk about the data collection portion of our research.
Here, we can see the location and number of trees planted and surveyed throughout Chicopee. About two-thirds of the trees that we measured were public trees, and we actually were able to measure 922 out of the 951 trees planted by the DCR up until this year. Trees that were left unmeasured were only done so if we lacked access to the property or lacked owner permission. We also calculated the city canopy cover and impervious surface across the entire city and within the planting zone. Impervious surface, an example of which would be planting or parking lots, roadways, and sidewalks. And impervious surface is a key indicator of surface heat in an area. And as you can see here, the Chicopee planting zone did have a relatively high percentage at 47%. I should note here that the DCR has expanded its planting zone farther to the south as they continue their planting progress. Here we can see the same information, but for Fall River. We were able to measure 1,349 out of the 1,988 trees planted in Fall River. Although Fall River had more than double the amount of trees planted than Chicopee, we were still able to measure more than two-thirds of them. A large area in the northern part of Fall River, not shown here in the map, but off in that direction, is a state forest, which certainly explains the high citywide canopy cover at 56%. But if you look within the planting zone and the percentages of impervious surface and canopy cover, you'll see that these are more accurate representations of an urban environment. Now, to better understand the progress and success of the Greening the Gateway Cities program, we identified two main areas of interest. Tree planting programs are often evaluated on their tree survivorship and their community engagement, and we chose to use these main themes throughout our own research. We were also interested in the differences between Chicopee and Fall River due to their different environmental factors and their organizational networks. Now, we will be moving into our tree survey section, and I will be discussing our data collection and specific measurements taken in our field program. To get at the question of survivorship and tree health, we chose to evaluate tree vigor using this rank scale of 1 through 5. This scale, beginning at 1, which denotes a healthy tree with a full canopy cover, shown here, progresses and increases in number as the canopy cover percentage decreases, ultimately reaching a 5, denoting a dead tree with no canopy cover. One thing I should note, you will see these pictures a lot, these are pictures of trees that we surveyed, and the numbers are the tree IDs assigned to them by the DCR. We and the DCR thought it important to include site type in our survey, as this metric can be used to make note of important locational and environmental stressors on the trees. We included residential yards as front yard, backyard, as well as side yard, which isn't shown here, maintained parks, as well as different types of sidewalk planting areas. Of equal importance to site type, but at a broader scale, we chose to make a distinction of land use of the surrounding area of planting trees. Residential land use was broken into single-family residences and multifamily residences. Single-family residences were further broken down into detached and attached units, defined by either having a single or up to three families in residence. An example of a single-family attached unit would be a duplex or a triple-decker. Multifamily residences were defined as having more than three families in residence, and an example of this would be an apartment complex. Throughout our tree survey, we also made note of any other indicators of tree health, such as basal sprouting. Basal sprouts, shown here, are a common indicator of tree stress across many species. We also made note of any environmental or human-caused damages, such as insect and trunk damage. We also encountered many situations of arbor lock problems, shown here at the end, an example of which a tree outgrowing its arbor lock. Whenever we encountered a situation like this, we made adjustments as needed, either adjusting the arbor lock or removing it entirely if that situation was appropriate. These are the physical measurements we took for all trees in our survey. We measured height, DBH, diameter at breast height, which is defined as 4.5 feet above the ground. And we also took measurements of width at 90 degree angles. I've been talking about our data collection methods up to this point. Now I'm going to hand you off to Liz, who will begin breaking down our tree statistics and comparisons.
okay, looking at our statistics starting with genus composition, we decided to aggregate things by genus instead of species because it simplified things and made the trends much clearer. We included any genus that had a representative tree planted across either city. And you can see that we surveyed 2,271 trees overall. And these are the top 10 trees planted, genera planted across both cities, with maple, oak, and linden standing apart as the most commonly planted ones. This is our survivorship, which, as you can see, was pretty great at 92%, which is among the highest ever recorded by HERO. In one of the surveys, alive is a tree that has a vigor between 1 and 4. Removed being we found evidence of there having had been a tree there, but there was no longer one. A stump is when we located a stump in the location. Standing dead was a vigor of 5, so the tree was still there, but it had no canopy. And unknown, we tried to reserve for situations where we couldn't locate the tree or find any evidence of where it has been. This is a picture of HERO fellow Rowan hugging a tree that was not part of our survey, but an example of what the DCR trees will look like in the future. Looking at species attributes, starting with native status, there's a lot of discourse in the scientific community right now as to what makes a tree native or not. We went with the USDA definitions based on whether a species was native to Massachusetts or not, and you can see that a majority were native. Hybrid slash unknown is a category reserved for species that were, for example, a dogwood that was the cross between the native and non-native species that didn't fit cleanly into either category. Breaking species down by species type, we had shade trees, which are large and designed to provide shade for the nearby areas. Ornamental, which were primarily flowering trees. And we decided to take fruit as its own category because we did find trees that were planted specifically for the purpose of bearing fruit. And evergreens, which in the past had been included with either ornamental or shade, but since they can have characteristics of both getting large enough to provide a large amount of shade and being considered by ornamental as ornamental by some people, we decided to separate it into its own category. Again, site type, as Rowan said, is the immediate surroundings of the tree where it is planted. You can see that the two green colors and purple here are residential, the different yard types, and that was the large majority of the trees that we surveyed. Maintained park is what you think of as a regular park. And other maintained is the category that doesn't fit well into residential, maintained, or street tree, which is a sidewalk head out road planting strip. So it's kind of the other category in a sense. This is land use composition, which is again broken down by residential for the building type, which was again a large majority. Maintained park is very similar to the site type maintained park. And here, other maintained is essentially broken down into commercial, industrial, and institutional. We're now going to start looking at tree health metrics. I'm going to take a moment to explain these stack bar graphs because you will be seeing a lot of them. I'd like to draw your attention to the fact that the axes are broken at 70%, which means 70% of all the trees were alive or had a survivor vigor of 1. But we decided to zoom in on the small percentages that weren't alive or had a lower vigor in order to show the patterns. Basically, it scales everything to 100% so you can compare across different sample sizes. And the reason that the ends are different for mortality and vigor is because we did not assign a vigor value to trees that were removed, stumps, or unknown. The trends that we see here are that front yard had slightly higher survivorship than backyard, which may be related to greater concerns about aesthetics in people's front yards. And other maintained may have lower survivorship because of this large block of unknown trees, which came from one property that was a retirement community where we couldn't locate any of the trees. Interestingly, sidewalk cutout had the highest survivorship but the lowest vigor, which may represent a tendency to either survive but not do well or to even die and be replanted by the DCR. So the trees we saw may have been more recent replantings, which is why they were all alive. Now looking at land use, interestingly, multifamily residential had the highest survivorship of any of the residential categories, which may go against expectations that in a building where there are many families living, no one family or person would feel ownership of the tree. But it may also be related to the fact that many of these types of buildings have site maintainers who, if they're communicated with, can lead to good results for the tree survivorship. commercial and industrial both had perfect survivorship, but opposite trends in vigor, that commercial had low vigor and industrial had perfect vigor, which may be related to the small sample sizes we got for those two land uses. This is health broken down by native status. We performed chi-square tests to see if there was statistical significance between native and non-native categories, and you can see the p-values here were both significant. So native did significantly worse than non-native in both survivorship and vigor, which doesn't necessarily mean that because they're native, they did worse. There may be other correlating factors with site type, land use, and stewardship. Another thing that I would like to note is that native is to, as to whether it is native in Massachusetts, there are no trees that are native to urban environments. So non-native trees that are chosen for urban environments, such as the ginkgo, may be hardier and perform better than trees that are native to Massachusetts, but Massachusetts forests. This is health broken down by species type, where we combined ornamental and fruit. Again, we performed the chi-squared test and found that there was a statistically significant difference, with ornamental and fruit having higher survivorship, and a mostly statistically significant result for vigor, but with the opposite trend, ornamental and fruit having lower vigor. This is a list of 10 species that had 100% survivorship with at least 10 individuals planted, which is great. There was, you can see that there's a large variety of species here, and these are pictures that are examples of healthy trees of these species that we encountered. Conversely, these are the species with lowest survivorship across both cities. Most of these trees, except for the black gum, had small numbers planted, but the dawn redwood, which only had 17 planted, had 40% survivorship, which isn't great. I'd also like to note that the fifth lowest species, Austrian pine, had 75% survivorship, which, though it is in the lowest five species here, is comparable to overall survivorship in many planting programs across the country, which is average of 75 to 80%. So the lowest here is comparable to the average in other planting programs. We're now going to start looking at statistics broken up across the species, starting again with genus composition. This bottom graph is the percentage of each genus planted, and you can see that there's a remarkable similarity across the two cities, despite the fact that they don't necessarily correlate or and they use different nursery staff, which is remarkable. And up here we have the numbers of each genus planted, and again, maple and oak are the highest, with linden, elm, and dogwood being in the top 10 for both cities, but in different positions. I'm now going to turn it over to Andy, who's going to continue with the statistics broken down by city.
So this is a comparison of native trees and non-native trees in Chicopee and Fall River. And as we can see, Fall River had a much higher percentage of native trees, while Chicopee had about a 50-50 split between native and non-native trees. And this is a comparison of species type between Chicopee and Fall River. So we can see that both cities had the same percentage of shade trees, while Chicopee had a slightly larger demand for fruiting trees. And I'd like to say that it's a good thing that the majority of trees planted in both of these cities were shade trees, because these will be the most effective for shading impervious surfaces and thus combating the urban heat island effect. So this is a comparison of site type between Chicopee and Fall River. Backyards, front yards, and side yards make up about two-thirds to three-fourths of all the trees in these cities. And we can see that Chicopee had many more trees in sidewalk planting strips, while Fall River had more trees in maintained parks. This is a comparison of the land uses in which trees were planted in Chicopee and Fall River. And greater than three-fourths of the trees were planted in residential areas. And to reiterate here, Fall River had more trees in maintained parks, while Chicopee had more trees in institutional land uses. So here's a flowchart of tree survivorship for Chicopee. Of the 922 trees in our sample, just under 92% live, which is very good survivorship for a single city. And of the alive trees, 90% were in very good healthy condition. And 36 of the trees that we measured were replacements for dead trees that the DCR had come in and replanted after the initial planting died. And then this is a flowchart for tree survivorship in Fall River. And I just want to let you know that you don't have to go see your optometrist just yet. The survivorship in Fall River and Chicopee was exactly the same at 91.7%. So that was kind of uncanny. We were amazed to find that out, that in two sample sizes with different numbers, it was the same exact survivorship down to the first decimal point. Of those alive trees, 85% were in very good healthy condition. So really, the only difference is that Fall River just had slightly more unhealthy trees than in Chicopee. So here are the most common species planted in Chicopee. We have the species name, the overall survivorship percentage, the number of that species planted, and the mean vigor of that species. So the one note that I'd like to make on this slide is that the tulip tree was the second most common planted tree, but it also had a fairly low survivorship compared to the other ones. And here's the species with the lowest survivorship in Chicopee. And once again, you see that the tulip tree was really the only species that had a substantial number planted but didn't do quite as well in the city. Here's the most commonly planted species in Fall River. These most commonly planted species had very high survivorship, which is really good to see, because if the most commonly planted species do very well, then that is really good for overall survivorship numbers. And you don't want to be planting large groups of trees and have them all not do very well. So this is really good to see. And I'd also like to single out the Freeman maple. In Fall River, there were 74 of them that we surveyed, and not one of them had died and had an almost perfect mean vigor of 1.05. So here are the species with the lowest survivorship in Fall River. And it's important to note here that the poor performing species tended to have really low numbers planted, which is good because it doesn't have a really negative overall hit on survivorship. And all that being said, with the exception of the black gum, which had 61 trees planted at 74% survivorship, but I'd like to reiterate what Liz said, that 74% survivorship really isn't all that bad compared to other tree planting programs in the country that average out around 75% to 80% survivorship. So now, to look more into how land use affects tree health, we consolidated the land use options that we measured into four broader categories that have different implications regarding ownership and thus tree stewardship and maintenance. And the main distinction between these categories is that private trees are taken care of by residents, where the other categories are mainly taken care of by DCR officials or hired maintenance crews. And street trees, trees in housing authorities, and trees in maintained parks are also experience more stresses, such as exposure to road sand and salt or vandalism, sometimes by like small children. So to break this down a little further, here's a comparison of tree survivorship based on ownership type in each city. And counting categories with only 10 trees or higher in them, street trees had the best overall survivorship in both cities, and residential trees also did very well in both of these cities. And in Fall River, there were many, many more trees that we measured in housing authorities and public parks than in Chicopee, so Fall River kind of carried our sample with regards to these two ownership types. And the trees in housing authorities and public parks also did very, very well, considering that they're mostly taken care of by maintenance crews, and there's not individual residents or families who feel a very strong connection to taking care of those trees. And this is a comparison of tree vigor based on ownership type in each city. And the first thing that stands out is that the vigor of street trees in Chicopee was much higher than in Fall River by about 15%. And residential trees also did very well in both of these cities. And we saw overwhelmingly high survivorship and vigor, but there was lower vigor for smaller groups of trees in what we're calling kind of gray areas of stewardship. here where it's kind of unclear whose direct responsibility it is to be taking care of the trees. And we saw many examples of these trees in or near vacant lots, near like industrial or commercial land use areas. And we also performed a chi-square test to see if there is a statistically significant difference in vigor between these ownership types. And our p-value of 0.057 tells us that ownership type really does have an impact on tree vigor. So now I'm going to introduce you to Yannette and Laura, who are going to go into a little more detail of the, into the interview responses.
Which focuses on interviews, the Greening the Gateway City program, and how the program works for different people. When we talk about sense of place and the idea of placemaking, we essentially mean the way people feel about their neighborhoods, the way policy works with them and impacts them, and how members of the community interact, and how all this ties together under the idea of place.
So these were the interviews that we were able to set up. We reached out to 161 residents, and out of those, 28 agreed to do an interview. And the rest that we did were out in the field when we asked residents if they would be willing to participate in the interview. And as you can see, we wanted to really listen on the opinions and thoughts that they had about the program. Since it was a small relative sample size of interviews that we collected, we decided not to break it down by city, but keep it together as a group. As you can see, over here to the right side, this is the notes, which represents the themes that came up through our interviews out of our analysis. And the one that was the most frequent from residential interviews was communication.
So our resident population was not typical for the average population of the Gateway City. The majority of our interviewees were older individuals, and this is possibly because we conducted interviews on weekdays during the daytime when they were the most likely to be home. Most were homeowners as opposed to renters in 1 to 2 person homes. 35% of the people interviewed had a bachelor's degree or higher, which is above average for a gateway city. There was also a higher proportion of English spoken at home than is typical as well. So essentially, our resident population was older, more educated, and richer than the average population of the Gateway City. This may reflect the time of day we were doing field work, as well as who was willing to talk to us, but it therefore should be noted that these demographics may not be completely representative of the general characteristics of Greening the Gateway City members. So these are our theme trees, which we love, right? And you can see there's even a little road going through them because they're street trees. So the size of the circles and the shading indicates the frequency of the theme and how often it came up in interviews. So as you can see, the organizational interviews are on the left and residential are on the right. The larger the circle and the darker it is, the more frequent the theme came up. So as you can see, communication came up very frequently for both organizations and residents. Networks came up more often for organizations than for residents, etc. And you will see these a lot throughout the rest of our presentation.
So in addition to doing residents' interviews, we also did organizations' interviews. And we were also able to interview someone from the City Planning Department. And in this image, this is two HERO fellows interviewing a member from the Fall River Street Planning Program member, and also he is also a DCR planter. So, in better to understand the organizations and how they work in each city, we decided to make flowcharts to understand the relationships. And each box has the name and the actions that each player does. So, the main three players in this is DCR, the City Planning Department, and Valley Opportunity Council in Chicopee. And so Valley Opportunity Council serves as the liaison, as they are well established in the community of Chicopee, and so they help with the outreach. And also, we did dotted lines, as we know that there are a player but we are not exactly sure what exactly their action is. And another thing that I wanted to point out is that the City Planning Department has a forestry department, and as well as they also do their own planting in the city as well. And so in Fall River, we see that there's no forestry department, and as well, we see less arrows. Again, the dotted arrows for Fall River is that we know for sure that there are players in the city, but we're not exactly sure of their roles, as we were not able to interview someone from the Department of Community and Maintenance. Okay, and so as we move on through the presentation, I will be talking about organizations which are on the left side, and Laura will be talking about residents' quotes, which will appear on the right side. So the two primary organizations are Valley Opportunity Council and Chicopee, as well as the Fall River Street Planning Program. These organizations, the tree organization has an obvious motivation for participating as they plant trees, as you can see in the bottom quote. While VLC and Chicopee does a lot of different things, despite that, it is in the best interest to continue to better the community. As organizations are aware that trees increase home value and it's energy efficient and also the aesthetic that it brings into the neighborhood.
So yeah, as Yana just said, residents are primarily interested in the aesthetics that trees offer their property. Often they have space to fill, whether they have a property that needs landscaping and they want some shade for the decorative trees, or whether they lost a large tree and want to replace it with a new one so their property doesn't look so bare. Another reason for resident participation is affordability. Many residents know how expensive it can be to purchase trees, and because the Greening the Gateway City program offers them for free, they feel like they kind of can't hesitate to sign up for free trees. Several residents are interested in the energy-saving benefits of shade, but often the shade is also just tied to the aesthetic benefits. Many want more privacy, often in the form of a border, like a fence, particularly out of evergreen trees. And some participate in the hope that it will bring more wildlife onto their property, like birds.
So, among the collaboration between the city and the other actors are important for the planting of trees. It's important to highlight one difference that exists in Chicopee, which is that the city planning department is very supportive of this initiative. And also another thing that I want to highlight, which is in the middle quote, Mary Ann Wardell, she was a resident and a volunteer, as well as the president of the Fall River Street Tree Planting Program. And she was a strong advocate of trees in the city.
So for residents, when looking at networks, we're looking at interactions that occurred as a result of trees and who the parties are in the networks. Most of the networking processes we observed appear to be neighbors informing each other about the program and discussing it. The networking seems to be therefore as much a result of the program as the trees themselves. It's almost always in pre-established circles, whether between neighbors or family members. And the first and last quote highlight the cases of neighbors talking to other neighbors, while the middle shows the case of an actual neighborhood meeting that was not for trees, but where trees came up in discussion.
So there's a lot of collaboration between organizations and DCR, which is important to continue to raise awareness of the planting of trees. Also, there's a joint effort that is done to continue to bring more a larger audience. All these efforts are towards planning and making sure that people are being educated through educational initiatives that are being done.
For residents, communication with the DCR is primarily in reference to how they found out about the Greening the Gateway Cities program, which, as the network suggested, was most often through other residents. As the first quote showed, and as Yana explained, Mary Ann Wardell was a resident of Fall River who knew many other residents and communicated the benefits of the program to them, and therefore brought many members to the program. If not through word of mouth, many residents found out about the program through indirect communication, like pamphlets, brochures, and flyers, or an article in the newspaper. But in addition to spreading word about the program's existence, the DCR also communicated with residents by providing them with information on tree care upon planting, typically through some type of literature. And the DCR also encourages residents to call if they have any questions, which keeps these lines of communication open.
So the program itself creates a awareness of responsibilities for organizations. One of the things that comes out is that the responsibilities of trees in the community. For example, in Fall River Street Tree Planting Program, they are in charge of the stewardship such as weeding and mulching of public trees.
So the topics of ownership and responsibility came up in reference to what individual owners felt their responsibility was for tree maintenance on their property. As well as what other organizations they thought should be involved or responsible in the community. So they were given a list of potential organizations that included the federal government, the state government, local government, private businesses, community and nonprofit organizations, as well as residents, and they were asked which of those they felt should be involved or responsible. And a good amount of the residents did just say yes to the entire list going all the way down, but the majority of residents thought that the city and state government should be involved in the maintenance of street trees. Regarding the federal government, opinion tended to be split between agreeing that they should be involved or believing that they should not have responsibility for city matters. For private businesses, people generally said yes, they should be involved, but couldn't see why they wouldn't want to take care of the trees and enhance the aesthetics of their property in the first place. And some residents thought that it would be unrealistic to expect community or nonprofit organizations to have the funds to participate in maintaining.
So these organizations decide to be involved as they are aware of the benefits that trees give to the community. And with knowing these benefits, they want to share these benefits to the community so that much down like the road, like DCR, it provides a shade to the community.
So yeah, as Yannette said, organizations really focus on sharing the benefits of trees and promoting the future effects for the community, but benefits for residents are centered much more around aesthetics. Many residents also mentioned the potential benefits of cooling, as well as increased property values, mainly again related to improved aesthetics in the community. One resident even said that trees improved the neighborhood's class, quote. Several also cited health benefits through more oxygen and fresher air, but it should be noted though, a handful of residents did not perceive or anticipate any effects of trees. Another effect for residents, though, is emotional impact, which is really about nostalgia and the feelings that people attribute to trees. So regarding nostalgia, several residents were reminded of a time when their area had significantly more tree canopy, perhaps associating it with their childhood, and viewing the program as a way to try to restore the neighborhood to how it once was. Some enjoy caring for trees to the point of attributing personal characteristics to them, as this first quote highlights, or babying them, as another resident said. But others simply feel emotions like happiness as a result of seeing the trees planted for any number of personal reasons. So regarding how residents care for trees, basically a high proportion of residents really go above and beyond in tree stewardship. But the majority appear to have watered their trees fairly diligently in the first year or two, and then done little since besides letting, quote, Mother Nature take care of it, especially when it rains or during the winter. So most residents primarily just water their trees, and that's about it. A few said they have done virtually nothing since their tree was planted, but many pruned their trees and used fertilizer. A few sprayed their trees with some type of fungicide or pesticide. A few noted keeping weeds away from the bottom or doing something to prevent trunk damage, like adding a cylinder around the base to keep squirrels and rabbits from preventing trunk damage.
So some of the challenges that organizations face is that first, when DCR came to the city, there was a lot of excitement among the residents and really and wanted to participate, but then also that momentum slowed down. And so it became a little bit harder to continue to sell the program to residents. And also, particularly in Chicopee, in recent memory for residents, in 2011, there was multiple tornadoes that affected Western Mass, and Chicopee was one of them. So in this sense, residents have expressed fear as they are scared of something falling because of this memory that has been in their memories.
There are several challenges that come with owning a tree that make residents hesitate to participate in the Greening the Gateway City program. Some brought up the aspect of cost, with water being expensive. Lots of residents brought up leaves and the issue of raking. Interestingly, fruit and flowering trees were viewed by some as more work simply because they would require more cleanup. In terms of size and damage, as Yannette mentioned, these are tied primarily to worries about inclement weather, which especially in Chicopee exists in many residents' recent memories. So people are worried about having a large tree near their house because they are worried about the damage it could cause if a branch were to fall or if something else were to happen. But the biggest concern for many of our residents, especially given how many of them were retired, was age limitations. Some expressed worry about not being able to carry water long distances, and they often wanted a simple property that they can take care of without need for assistance. But it's important to note that these are residents who still took trees despite these challenges. We can only imagine that these concerns are magnified for people who chose not to participate in the program, making this only the tip of the iceberg. The residents had several suggestions for improvement of the Greening the Gateway Cities program. A large proportion mentioned that the program could have better outreach in the form of advertising to make residents more aware of the program's existence. Some suggested putting signs up in yards of properties that have received trees, as Chicopee has done in several instances, more flyers, and acknowledging that because many residents throw out brochures they receive in the mail without even reading them, perhaps an alternative or electronic approach should be tried. Regarding service, an equally large proportion of residents suggested notifying residents the day of planting, leaving explicit instructions on how to maintain trees after the DCR leaves, checking in with residents once a year, and leaving a note on the door or calling after they have come to check up on trees. But in terms of outside involvement, several residents think that the program could use additional funding, many believing that a lack of funding is the reason that the program does not plant trees in more areas. So we would even suggest a more thorough explanation of the program to residents involved so that they would realize that a lack of funding is not the reason that the program only plants in particular zones. So in summary, our first question asked how the Greening the Gateway City program influenced the identities of organizational actors and residents relative to their sense of place. What we found is that the program adds to their roles in the community, particularly as stewards. Organizational actors are the primary stewards for public trees, while residents, on the other hand, take responsibility for trees on their property. We also asked how interactions between organizational actors and residents shaped the placemaking process, in large part asking how they felt about their neighborhoods. Residents credit trees with beautification, cooling, increased property values, and health benefits. They also attribute characteristics to them, like emotion and nostalgia. Organizations do perceive these same benefits, but with an additional broader community outlook. So these benefits shape how organizational actors and residents feel about their community because they extend these benefits to the entire neighborhood. This allows organizational actors and participants alike take pride in what residents deem a more aesthetically pleasing community and what organizations feel is a more environmentally conscious one. And regarding how the Greening the Gateway Cities program intersects with stakeholder goals and efforts, the intersection of residents and organizations through the Greening the Gateway City program allows residents to receive trees and their perceived benefits through the DCR, while resident participation allows for the Greening the Gateway Cities program to continue. And so with that, Rowan will now summarize the rest of our research findings.
To broaden the extent of our research findings, we've compared cities that Hero Fellows have measured both this year and in 2017. Fall River, Chicopee, Holyoke, Chelsea, and Revere are all compared here across survivorship and mean tree measurements. Really, the most important and interesting values to make note of here are the incredible survivorship ratings found in both Fall River and Chicopee at 92%. Although Revere was found to have a higher survivorship of 94% last year, the sample sizes in Fall River and Chicopee are so much larger and include a more diverse range of tree and planting types that we consider these values to be most significant. Another significant value to make note is the mean vigor score of Chicopee, Mass, which is greater than all other cities, with Fall River trees also performing very well. To summarize our findings, we have identified a few main trends throughout our research. First, regarding tree vigor and survivorship, we found there to be many consistencies across both cities of Chicopee and Massachusetts, such as planting locations with clear lines of stewardship had better performing trees. Also, we found significant differences in vigor and survivorship between different tree types and planting types. Moving now on to program progress and placemaking. Under our broad definition of placemaking, which includes policy, actors, impact of thoughts on neighborhoods and relationships, we found there to be an interesting link between residents and their perceived benefits of trees. This factor increases networking among actors as residents spread information regarding the planting program. These networks can influence change in how residents interact with their community space, such as their parks and their streets. Meanwhile, organizations tended to be more concerned with the future environmental impacts upon their communities. Now, Rachel is going to continue breaking down our observations and discuss the future goals for the HERO research program.
So we put together some observations and future program recommendations. What we found most crucial was that there were a high number of shade trees planted with a high survivorship. And this is a key player in the program's success overall. As Andy discussed previously, commonly planted species also displayed high survivorship as well, which also impacts program success for the better. Secondly, residents are eager for more DCR engagement, whether that be more tree care notes or even annual check-ins, and an increased marketing presence. Here is a picture of HERO fellow Andy posing with one of the street signs in Chicopee. And here we see a rare cement tree in its natural habitat. Someone had poured cement over this DCR planted tree's root flare. And this is a good example of a tree that was planted in an area where it's unclear who was responsible for maintaining it. We also noticed that when multiple planting programs intersect, for example, in Chicopee, the city of Chicopee has its own planting initiatives that work in addition to other planting programs. So we found that when this happens, stewardship and communication often becomes a little bit confusing, and this could lead to lower survivorship. We have seen actors interacting in new ways, but still have questions about organizations, their actors, and how they work. We would also like to better understand non-participants and how to reach out to them. We would also like to better understand lines of communication between organizations and governments, as well as stakeholders. To wrap things up, we want to acknowledge everyone that helped make this all possible. The leaders and volunteers at the Valley Opportunity Council and the Fall River Street Tree Planting Program, the residents and stakeholders who took time out of their day to be interviewed, the residents of Fall River and Chicopee who welcomed complete strangers in neon vests and a 10-foot pole onto their property. Thank you to the John T. O'Connor Fund for Environmental Studies, Rachel Levitt and Kayla Peterson, our administrative assistants, who were extremely helpful. Pamela Dunkel, Arthur Elms, are part of the DCR, Matt Cahill, Rachel DiMattei, Sarah Greenleaf, and Todd Gildersleeve. And last but not least, thank you to Laura Roman from the United States Forest Service, who visited us in the field all the way from Philadelphia and helped establish our vigor metrics, as well as being available to answer all the questions we have. Thank you all for coming out today. We not only learned a lot about interdisciplinary data collection, but how important trees are to our communities. And you all helped make that possible. So thank you very much.
At this time, we'd like to open up the floor for any questions you have regarding our presentation.
Not a question, but just a comment, really. So Matt Cahill with DCR, so thank you. Thank you, Clark. Thank you for all your work. We've been doing this for many years now, and it's been really great to see the change over time. And I'm not going to compare the different hero years, but it gets better every year. It's been really great. Your results are very informative. And the best part about this that we talk about when we sit down and brainstorm is that you give us usable information that we can actually take back into this program. So just so that you continue to hear that your work is valuable, and we appreciate what you've done.
We would like to. We just don't know if we have the resources available at the moment to make that happen. It's a goal, but not necessarily a plan, if that answers your question.
That question has come up a lot.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that future hero groups are going to continue to look at different green and gateway cities to see what's going on there. But as far as revisiting the cities, I don't know if that will be up to us. But I think it would be good for the DCR to go back in a couple of years and assess survivorship of the trees.
Also, we miss the residents.
We miss their dog.
In both of those areas, gypsy moth is playing a role. Did you guys see any of that on these young trees? And did it play a role in your health rating?
We saw gypsy moths, not as much as we have in Worcester. It's been crazy in Worcester this year. But we did have a note section where we would make note of extensive caterpillar damage if it was enough that it seemed like something that we should write down. And if it was significant enough that it affected the percentage of canopy present, it did factor into the vigor score.
A lot of residents sprayed their trees with the fungicide to prevent the caterpillar damage. So they also noticed it as well.
The quote about the one where she loved it so much and she was afraid someone would steal it and she would talk to it, she was mourning it. She was very, very upset.
Yeah.
She said, "Can I have another one?" It's not up to me.
You can just call them.
Just call them.
When you talk about demographics in both of the communities, you tie that into the environmental justice component that is part of the Commonwealth, because you didn't really talk about those three characteristics in an environmental justice area. You just sort of talked about the demographic of it, of white and Hispanic and that. So is there a tie-in with the EJ neighborhood information?
Yes, definitely. So the environmental, I created the demographics maps,
yep.
And the environmental justice demographic information was used to determine planning zones.
Okay.
And when I was creating these maps, the environmental justice data layer did not cover the full planting zone. So I used U.S. Census data and manually edited the data layers. So with the demographic information that was provided over Plaza 2 cities, we picked what we figured they would have used when determining what makes these cities gateway cities, and what makes them good candidates for planting zones, which areas are best for planting zones, et cetera.
think one of the main goals is to make sure that all demographics have equal exposure to urban canopy.
What do you think that people just walking by, like using the sidewalk as a pedestrian, or people that use walking as a mode of transportation think of these trees?
Most of them, well, they think it really beautifies the community a lot. That's, as we were saying, aesthetics was a very, very large part of it. And so all the associated benefits that residents who participate in the program have with trees, people who just kind of see the trees on the sidewalk also see them as upgrading the overall look of the neighborhood. Some people think, you know, that contributes to higher property values. But we saw or heard a lot more about people getting out more into their community because they found it so much nicer to be in. Parents talking about how they were taking their kids to the park as opposed to not doing that so much before. So it's a pretty broad answer, but a lot of people kind of react to them in different ways, but it's generally really positive.
I was kind of surprised to see the survivability rates of Holyoke with the Holyoke, Chigbee Holyoke planting crew. I know you guys did a lot of surveying there. The soils there were pretty tough for us to dig, and that's, I'm really shocked that a lot of our survivability rates went up. You guys came across all that stuff, you looked around, like looking at the soils and taking that into account with you know, the losses.
So we didn't sample any trees in Holyoke, but that was last year, I believe, last year's cohort, but we did survey all the trees in Chicopee. And we actually, in Chicopee, we had a lot of residents tell us that the soils were especially good because it's in a river valley.
Yeah.
So is that different than in Holyoke?
Yes, we had a lot of industrial fill, like first 5-6 inches was just all brick, concrete,
okay,
asphalt,
yeah.
A lot of that. Chicopee, completely different.
Right. We're not experts on soil composition, but that definitely does have an effect on the tree health. But residents were very expressive about the good soil quality in Chicopee. They all had like
and a lot of gardens.
Yeah, crazy gardens. Really, really productive gardens.
Super proud of them.
Early in the season.
Yeah, we would love to take soil more into account, but at this time we don't really have the resources to do the kind of soil testing for every tree that would make it a valuable metric.
When we were doing the interviews at people's residences, did you sort of look at kind of how their whole property, like what the stewardship of the property was like, in addition to how the tree was doing?
I couldn't really help but mentally note that when some of the gardens were so nice and some of the properties were so well maintained. It wasn't anything that really factored into our like research and assessment of the trees. Like sometimes you have a very crowded, messy backyard, and the tree itself would be doing absolutely great, so you couldn't really say anything about it. I mean, Liz and I once talked about a tree that was growing in between 2 feet behind
the
shed
like,
and a fence.
There was a fence, and it had been planted, and then they put a shed in, and there was like maybe this much space between the shed and the fence, and one of the trees was dead, and the other one was doing fine. So
yeah, like literally bigger than one.
Yes.
I'd say that more times than not, the people that did have trees had very well-kept lawns, so I think the folks who were really into landscaping and having a nice aesthetically pleasing yard were just, you know, jumping at the gun to get more trees.
One resident had a detailed notebook of every single plant that was planted on her property.
She was going through with us, like, double-checking.
She's like, I think I had it here somewhere.
Okay, if there aren't any more questions, we'll end this portion and let's have a nice discussion together after this and help ourselves to food and drink. So thanks very much.